So NBA free agency started yesterday, and right out of the gate, we had moves galore. Kevin Durant, Kyrie Irving, and DeAndre Jordan going to New York, but not the Knicks. Instead, going to the Brooklyn Nets. That makes Nets very interesting moving forward. I'm not going to linger too much on this. Just know that it's a circus. KD had a falling out with Golden State, felt he was disrespected, and pretty much since August has been just done with that team and any notion of returning. Go figure. Locally, there's been a lot of mixed feelings on Dallas's early approach. Now, the positive is that Dallas signs Kristaps Porzingis to a 5-year, $158 million max contract. Now, why is this important? Well, not only do you secure your second building block, your second franchise cornerstone piece for the future, but you don't have to worry about anything long term. There are no player options. There are no team options. This is a fully guaranteed deal. And Dallas has now had several extra months, obviously, all the way back to end of January when they acquired Kristaps. They know the status of his physical health. So the fact that there are no caveats to this deal tells me that they are all in and that they believe he is ready. Don't forget the Mavericks have, arguably, with Casey Smith, the best training staff in the NBA and a renowned training staff at that. So no red flags there to me. I know some people don't like to consider this like, oh, well, we've already had him, so it's not a new guy. Therefore, how is this our biggest move? Well, aside from the fact that it locks you up long term with the unicorn, you got to remember, man, there were reports literally within 20 minutes of acquiring Porzingis saying that he was going to take a qualifying offer this coming season so that he could be an unrestricted free agent following that. Why? Because Dallas was not on his short list of teams for where he wanted to go. That is how day one could have gone worse for the Mavericks. Imagine if you don't get that 5-year deal and he takes the qualifying offer and suddenly you're looking at the future saying, holy shit. KP locked into Dallas long term. Of course, that's a big thumbs up from me. So next, we got Dwight Powell signing a new deal as well. Now, obviously, I'm not hitting all the NBA free agency news here. I'm sticking with the local focus now. The other stuff was just initial context for the initial wave of deals. Dwight Powell staying a Maverick makes a lot of sense. Obviously, he is the last piece from the disastrous Rajon Rondo trade. And you know what? He's been a pretty good player for us. He's gotten better every year he's been here. I don't like him as a starter, but I think as a role player, he's got quality to him. After the Mavericks season ended, you heard Mark Cuban talking about they were probably going to give him something like a 3-year, $50 million extension. Then there was talk that Dwight Powell was opting out of his player option, which was $10.2 million. Then you heard, no, he's actually going to opt into that deal. He doesn't even know where that report came from because it's not accurate. Well, here's the thing, guys. Something to keep in mind. Dwight Powell signs 3 years. Whew, got a step ahead of myself. 3 years for $33 million. I'm going to say that again. We were hearing at the end of the season he was going to be 3 for $50. We got him 3 for $33. And because he opted into his player option this coming season, that doesn't kick in until after this season. So really, you got 4 more years with Dwight Powell here, but he's not going up in money that much. He's going from 10.2 to 11. That is very agreeable, and it did not impact our cap space for free agency this year. So anyone who maybe is on the fence or even anti-Dwight Powell, don't fret too bad. It does not impact everything else going on with the Mavericks. After that, man, we went damn quiet day one. We heard talks that Dallas was in contract talks with Danny Green, but that's not going to happen unless we see what happens first with Kawhi Leonard. Danny Green is very adamant that, you know, he's been Kawhi's teammate with the Spurs for several years, and then this past year with the Raptors, he's been with him 4 or 5 years now. So they're tight. And if Danny Green is to come to Dallas, what has to happen is Kawhi Leonard has to leave Toronto. Whether whether Danny Green would potentially be able and willing to follow him to the Clippers. That, to me, still seems like it's on the table. I haven't looked at the exact cap situation for the Clippers just yet. But considering the Clippers had talks about possibly pairing Jimmy Butler and Kawhi at one point, I'm going to go out on a limb and say he's probably still available to them, Danny Green is, if they get Kawhi Leonard. So if Kawhi goes to the Lakers, which I do not want to see, then that opens the door for Danny Green to Dallas. It sounds like the talk's really heated up, that that's probably the best option out there. I've been high on the Danny Green train for months now. He's a very good, very competent 3-and-D guy. He prides himself on his defense. He's a two-time champion, has the NBA Finals record. In a single NBA Finals, he has the record for most three-pointers made. Not Steph Curry, not Klay Thompson, not Kevin Durant, not Ray Allen. He beat Ray Allen's record for that. He has the record. Danny Green does. You put him in a system based around spacing and ball movement, which now you're going to have with Luka. Ooh. And you give a defender that you can put between Luka and KP out there as well in your lineup. So that makes a lot of sense. Another move that fell away. I'm not going to sugarcoat this, guys. Things got away from us yesterday. As a franchise, things got away from us. We had a phone call scheduled with Patrick Beverley, and the word was from Tim McMahon, Dallas was going to likely get Patrick Beverley 3 years, $40 million. I said, I love that. Sign me up. 13-3 a year for Pat Bev made a lot of sense. Another 3-and-D guy, can guard multiple positions, shot 39% from three last year, and he's off-ball point guard, which means you don't take the ball out of Luka's hands. All of that lined up perfect and made almost too much sense, in my opinion. And so naturally, we found a way to kind of sabotage that. Well, I guess maybe that's a strong word. You can look at it two ways, right? We know that the phone call did not end up happening, and then Beverley took that same three-year, $40 million contract with the Clippers to remain in LA. So what does that mean? Well, that could have gone two ways. Either we bungled the whole situation by getting involved in that potential sign-and-trade, three-team sign-and-trade deal for Jimmy Butler, and then we were so entangled in that mess that money was basically on hold for us and we couldn't figure it out, couldn't sort it out, and Beverley just got tired of waiting and maybe felt slighted by us skipping out on that meeting with him, essentially, the phone conference meeting, and therefore re-opted for that deal with the Clippers. That's one possibility. Or we had already gotten the indication, potentially, that Beverley, you know what, I think I'm going to go back to the Clippers. In which case, the Mavericks, there's no fault for them to back away from that unless, you know, I'm sure if Dallas had been like, oh yeah, what if we give you $45 million? Would you come here then? Yeah, yeah, especially with the no state income tax. Yeah, yeah, you'll keep a bigger chunk of that money. I don't know, man. I don't know what the possibility is. But regardless, Dallas gets tied up in that three-team trade last night. We get conflicting reports. We get all kinds of chaos. I even reported on the Dallas Prospect Facebook page incorrectly that we had acquired Goran Dragic because that's what we were told at the time. We were told that Jimmy Butler was signed and traded to the Heat on a max contract. And in the deal, Dallas was getting back Goran Dragic, the only other Slovenian player in the NBA. He's tight with Luka. They've won championships in the EuroLeague, I believe, together, or at least some prominent tournament. Forgive me, I should say, for missing that. But then we hear, no, Goran Dragic and his $19 million player option was not in the deal for Dallas. Dallas is instead getting Kelly Olynyk and Derrick Jones Jr. Derrick Jones Jr. is a legit high flyer, and he would be exciting to watch in this lineup. Kelly Olynyk, he's kind of faded away into obscurity since leaving Boston and getting all that money to go to Miami. But, you know, technically Dallas drafted him. They just immediately sent him to Boston for cap space, and we ended up with Shane Larkin in that whole situation. So, I don't know how to feel about that. That duo did not excite me hearing that that's what we were going to acquire in helping with the sign-and-trade because I thought... Well, why don't we have any picks or anything coming to us? If we're the third team helping facilitate this trade, why is that not what we're getting? It didn't make sense what we were getting in return. Like, why are we helping them with this if it's only a small boost and it's a questionable kind of fit to some degree? And then it got even more confusing because what happened after that? Oh, well, now Miami's saying, oh, no. We didn't think that Derrick Jones Jr. was in this deal. No, we don't want to trade him. To which Dallas said, what? How? What do you mean? We've been talking about this. How they had multiple conversations, how Philadelphia and Miami both thought that this was a done deal and that Goran Dragic was coming to Dallas, whereas Dallas says, no, we never wanted Goran Dragic in this situation. Because of his cap figure, they never wanted him in that sense. I don't know. It's very, very unusual how that came to be. But the end result is that the deal falls apart. Jimmy Butler is still dangling out there. The trade talks broke off. Whole trade canceled because without Goran Dragic in the deal, the financial numbers didn't work. And therefore, it's not a legal trade that the NBA can put through. So with that said, Dallas wasted hours last night. They missed the Beverly conference call. Beverly re-ups with his team. And then we were kind of left dangling in the wind. And I can't help but feel that we botched day one. Yes, we got KP, and that's huge. That's mammoth. Again, you look at him and his qualifying offer previously, what we thought we were going to possibly get from the day we traded him to getting that five-year, $158 million contract, and that they feel so confident they didn't even put in a player option or something like that. That's huge. Huge. And that can't be stressed enough. But after that, we just kind of took care of our own, you know? We got Dwight a new deal. Didn't do a whole lot else that day. But now today, it's about 2 o'clock now, Central Standard Time, as I'm recording this. We've made a couple moves today. We decided to bring back another former Maverick, another guy that I am a fan of for sure. Seth Curry is coming back to Dallas. Now, I don't know how long some of you have been watching the Dallas prospect. If you were watching at the start of last year, you saw me rage for weeks about letting him get away. And I understand, you know, he left Dallas after a solid year with the Mavericks. He was here 2 years, but he missed all of that second year with a stress reaction, and I believe it was his left leg. And his first year with us, he was really good. 12.8 points per game, I want to say. I want to say something like a 54.9% true shooting percentage. Lethal three-point shooter. Great elite three-point shooter. Obviously shot 45% from three last year on a little over 3.5 attempts a game, I want to say. And he fits very well into the offensive system for Rick Carlisle. So it makes sense to bring him back. And when we lost him, we didn't lose him because we weren't willing to give the kind of money that Portland gave. It's that Portland was the 3 seed the year before. They were a 3 seed again this year. And he had a more defined role there, a less crowded backcourt. It made sense for him to go there. I wanted him back. I was so mad that we lost him. And here, let me be clear on this. He wasn't my top priority in free agency. I wanted Beverly. I've wanted Danny Green. That's still on the table. And I think if they get Danny Green and pair him with Curry and getting KP, again, it's not a sexy offseason, so to speak, but it's still a solid one in terms of improving your team, kind of keeping your powder dry, if you will, and moving forward. But we're bringing him back on a 4-year, $32 million contract. Given what's happened, I love that. Here's why. Again, great three-point shooter, great free throw shooter as well on this team. That does matter because we've not been a good free throw shooting team in recent years. He's an okay defender, not great, but a competent defender, I would say, in most situations. And you now get to see, you saw how good he was playing with, see, so 2 years ago, so you saw, you didn't even get to see him with Dennis Smith Jr. Yeah. His 1 year with Dallas actually being able to play was the year before Dennis, and then he didn't play with Dennis because of his injury. And then this year, he was in Portland. So you saw with Barea and Devin Harris and Harrison Barnes, guys like that, how good he could be on a really bad Mavericks team. Imagine what he can do now alongside Luka Doncic, who is a phenomenal passer, great vision, great playmaker. Imagine what he can do alongside him, what he can do with KP and the gravity he brings. We always talked about Dirk, how his scoring ability and his shooting gave him almost like a gravity around him. So you run a pick and roll game with him, his gravity is going to suck in the defense and keep the help defense away, which is going to get better looks. Jason Terry talked about this all the time and how that made him so much better. It made life easier. Same thing for Monte Ellis when he came through here. Obviously, as the years wore on, Dirk's lethality in that sense kind of dropped back, but it's still something where it was always a big selling point. Well, KP has that same ability. KP is going to do that. So you take in what Luka can do for Curry in terms of giving him great looks. You take what KP can do in terms of keeping the defense away from him, making them a step slow because they got to stop and at least think about where KP is and if they're going out of position to pick up and contest the shot, thereby giving KP an easy look. All things that have to be considered. That's all going to benefit Seth Curry. And to get him an $8 million a year, dude, that's a good deal. It really is. $8 million per year. Now, I think he's going to be a backup. He's not a starter. I love this pickup. I was lamenting all year long when we saw how good Luka is and how good he may be. I was lamenting fairly regularly, I want to say, like, oh, just imagine if we still had Seth Curry on this team. Imagine the kind of looks we can get. Now, he still does have a little bit of a crowded backcourt to contend with. I think the Dallas Mavericks are going to find a way to move or even just waive Courtney Lee and stretch provision his contract out over a couple seasons. But you are going to have a situation where you still have Tim Hardaway Jr. I don't think Dallas is getting rid of him and Lee. So you're going to have Tim Hardaway Jr. You're going to have, you know, Curry there as well. You have Brunson there. Brunson's a point guard, not a shooting guard, so he shouldn't contend too much with Curry in terms of stepping on each other's toes in terms of minutes. And even then, NBA basketball is pretty much positionless in this day and age, so you can still find lineups where you roll them out there and get some unique looks. But there's a lot of possibility for him there. I don't know if they're going to bring back J.J. Barea. I wouldn't be shocked in the least if they brought him back on a vet minimum or maybe a notch above a vet minimum whenever they determine, hey, we're out of moves that we can make for this offseason. You know, we got like $2.6 million or something left. Pretty much out of any moves we can make and that we want to make. So, hey, Brea, here, we'll just throw the rest of this to you and you come on back, run it back for, you know, maybe one more year here in Dallas. That's what I foresee happening in that case. But it makes a lot of sense, makes them better. Speaking of moves, after the Curry deal, we then saw a long-term deal. Oop, not the mic. We then saw a long-term deal for Maxi Kleber. Maxi is staying here. He gets his own four-year deal worth, I've seen it reported by Mark Stein as $35 million, and I've seen it reported by Tim McMahon as $33 million. Regardless, Maxi Kleber was our best rim protector all of last year, including when DeAndre Jordan was here. Full stop. Not even a contest. Maxi Kleber is a great shot blocker. He's a serviceable stretch four, I would say. I don't love the idea of him being a starter, and he's thankfully not going to have to be asked to be that here in Dallas, but it's another move that has to be, I think, applauded because you're keeping another very useful component to your team, and whether you're actually able to keep him throughout the entirety of that contract or at some point he still has enough value and interest about him that if you do look to make a deal, say, as early as the trade deadline this year or the next summer or whatever, he's the kind of prospect that you can move. He's not really a prospect, I guess, at this point. Prospect, you tend to think young and on the way up, but he's not peaked yet, I don't think. So he's still got value in that regard. I think it's a good good re-signing there. So in summary, KP, locked up long-term, great. Dwight, locked up, way cheaper than we thought he was going to be, great. He might have to be a starter depending on what our lineup we roll out is. I don't love that, but he's improved every year here, and he'll have better talent around him now. So let's just see how that looks. Seth Curry, welcome back. Hell yes, I'm excited. Were you my first choice? No, but that said, I'm still happy to have you back, and I'm happy to see what we're going to be able to do with you and how that's going to make this team better. Because lethal three-point shooting with a guy like Luka, with a guy like KP, son. Extend Maxi, another four-year deal there. Very, very agreeable, man. Maxi and Dwight, Locked On Mavs calls them the ice climbers. That's pretty much exactly right. When they're together, they're a lethal 1-2 punch, and they both get re-upped this summer at pretty much the same contract. So kind of interesting there. Yeah, man, we just got to see. I'll keep you guys updated as more news comes down, as the Mavericks make more moves, say whether it's Danny Green, say if it's someone else of any note or significance. I'll jump back on here. I'll give you guys the update, but I'm going to be honest with you guys. Day one, I think we botched it largely in terms of free agent pursuit. I think we sat back on our heels with the assumption being that those secondary tier guys weren't going to go anywhere on day one, or at least not the lion's share of them. And because all we heard was, hey, there's going to be two big dominoes that have to fall, and then it's going to be a floodgate. We were hearing that even from Woj, that once Kawhi Leonard and Jimmy Butler went wherever they were going to go, at that point, you would see a dam breaking and all these other moves coming out. Well, that ended up being dead wrong. Dead wrong. Nobody waited. Everybody was flying off the table. Teams that seemingly had no cap space were making moves and picking up guys. So this belief that the Mavericks had that, hey, they were one of the teams with, I think, in the top six teams in terms of cap space, and that with all the guys that were out there and with the available money that the teams had, no matter what, the Mavericks were supposed to be walking away with something good. And I think the Mavericks took that and kind of sat back on their heels and decided that they were going to be patient, that they were going to wait. Dude, no. Bro, no. What are you doing? If you can make the move, you go make the move. You don't try and wait out a guy's market. Say a Pat Beverly, if you wanted to get him and you're like, ah, you know, we were hearing that the Clippers didn't want to give him a third year, and that's part of why we started hearing from Tim McMahon the Mavericks might be the inside track for him, or have the inside track for him, because they were willing to do that. If obviously the Clippers came around on that, but if you're Dallas, man, okay, even when the Clippers came around on it, why would you not just say, 3 for 42? It's not that big of a difference, and at that point, you're making a pitch. But it just feels like they sat back on their heels, and then things were happening around them, and it's kind of like the burning house thing. You've seen the meme where you got the dog sitting there, and the house is burning around him, and he's just like, this is fine. It's kind of what it felt like after they got their first couple moves yesterday. I know that's how the fan base feels. Thankfully, we're not the New York Knicks. I don't mean to keep kicking dirt in their face. I know they've made several new addition signings, but dude, there's not a single guy that they've brought on other than Julius Randle that's even like half moved the needle for me. And even in Randle's case, I was just like, all right, cool. The Knicks have picked up a bunch of bits and pieces that I don't think make that big of a difference. And considering how much they bungled it, that the only reason, not necessarily the only reason, but one of the big reasons they didn't get Kevin Durant is because they wouldn't give him a full max because they were worried about his recovery from the Achilles. Are you kidding me? That, as much as we might want to be frustrated with Donnie Nelson and the owner, in this case, Mark Cuban, don't get it twisted. Dolan is the embodiment of disastrous leadership and ownership. You don't want that trash. You don't. So be glad the Mavericks are making subtle moves. They're making small moves, but I do think that at the same time, they are making the team better. They're keeping a lot of the foundation in place. They got the long-term commitment from KP they needed, and with adding Seth Curry, they give you another sharpshooting guard. That's good. That's something that they need, because he'll get minutes now that Devin Harris was getting last year. And I love Devin Harris, but it doesn't make sense for him to come back to Dallas, I don't feel. So you're getting that, and you're getting a four-year commitment from a guy at $8 million. With how the value of things go, literally within, it's already a good deal. But literally, by the time you're 2 years into this thing, you're going to be looking at it and saying, this is a freaking steal. Got the guys that have numbers and ability like him are making $14, $16 million a year right now. He's making half of that and giving us everything. Everything that those other guys are giving their teams. So we'll see what happens. Another name I'd like to throw out there, I haven't heard traction in the media sources around the Mavericks for this, but Kayvon Looney, that would be my pitch for who to put alongside Porzingis. He's been with the Warriors. He's very good. In that regard, I think he would be a good fit alongside Porzingis. I don't know how gettable he is right now, or what even he's looking to get in terms of a contract, but that's another name. If you give me Kayvon Looney and Danny Green somehow, okay, I'm game. And I don't know the exact cap figures for the Mavericks after this. I believe they had $21 million left, and then they did the maxi deal, so that's going to change that figure, obviously. So you probably can't add two of them with how it is right now, but I do think that they're going to make some move, whether it be a trade or something like that, to get it done. And we'll go from there, man. But I've rambled long enough. I'll be back on later in the week for another show. I'll try and get Zach Cunningham back on here, whether it's pre-recorded or live. I might do something with him tomorrow on that. I know Big Game James wants to come on here and talk some Mavericks as well. And then, of course, next Sunday we'll be doing Mavs Fast Break again with Any. So hang tight. A lot of great stuff coming. Till next time, guys, remember, every legend was once a prospect. Salute.